إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونتوب إليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن سيدنا ومولانا محمدا عبده المصطفى ونبيه المجتبى ورسوله المرتضى خاتم الأنبياء وإمام الأتقياء وسيد المرسلين وحبيب رب العالمين صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين اللهم صل وسلم على سيد محمد مفتاح باب رحمة الله وسيد الأسرار ونور الأنوار المجتبى والمختار وعلى آله وأصحابه الأخيار المهاجرين والأنصار وسلم تسليما كثيرا أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون صدق الله العلي العظيم وقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم إنما بعثت لأتمم مكارم الأخلاق أو كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام أما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته This is just a very short reminder on this blessed day of Eid, a very joyous occasion for Muslims all around the world, a reminder to myself and by extension to all of you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ That whoever places their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah is enough for him. That all we need is Allah. Allah suffices him. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ God suffices us. An excellent guardian he is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, this is what the believer said, what the sahaba said in Medina, when the munafiqeen in the city of Medina, they were telling the sahaba that a great army is gathering against you. إِنَّ النَّاسَ قَدْ جَمَعُوا لَكُمْ فَخْشَوْهُمْ The people are gathering against you, so be afraid of them. فَزَادَهُمْ إِيمَانًا Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that this only increased them in their faith, in their iman. What the munafiqeen were telling them only increased the believers in faith. وَقَالُوا حَسْبُنَا اللَّهُ And they said, Allah suffices us. وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ An excellent guardian he is. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنْ يَنْصُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ That if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you victory, no one can overcome you. وَإِنْ يَخْذُلْكُمْ فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِهِ But if he forsakes you, who can possibly give you victory after that? وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ And upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let the believers place their trust. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our protector. Wallahu waliyul mu'mineen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our protector. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who protects us and guards us and guides us. And He is sufficient. He is wholly sufficient unto us. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is related that Imam Ali al-Rida He came and he visited a major city and thousands of people came out to meet him. And they asked him, give us something, give us some words of advice. And he said that I heard from my father, Musa al-Kadhim, who heard from his father, Ja'far al-Sadiq, who heard from his father, Muhammad al-Baqir, who heard from his father, Hussein ibn Ali, Zainul Abidin, who heard from his father, Hussein ibn Ali, who heard from his father, Ali ibn Abi Talib, who heard from his father, who heard from his father-in-law, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who heard from Jibril alayhi salam, the angel Gabriel, who heard from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, La ilaha illallah husni. وَمَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ بِصُدْقٍ فَدَخَلَ حُسْنِي وَمَنْ دَخَلَ حُسْنِي فَقَدْ أَمِنَ مِنْ عَذَابِي That لا إله إلا الله, there is no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is my fortress. So whoever says La ilaha illallah with sincerity has entered my fortress. And whoever enters my fortress is safe, is secure from my punishment. And the adab mentioned in the statement is the adab of the next life, the adab of entering Jahannam and abiding therein. The ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will achieve salvation. قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. This is the promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَعَدَ اللَّهِ حَقْ وَمَنْ أَسْتَقُوا مِنَ اللَّهِ قِيلَ. The promise of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is true. Allah never breaks a promise. He never breaks a trust. Who is more truthful in his speech than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam will achieve salvation in the form of paradise and spiritual proximity to their Lord. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Ummati hadihi ummatun marhuma. This ummah of mine is an ummah that has been granted mercy, and its punishment is in the dunya, in the world. And that is, when you think about it, in and of itself, a form of mercy. Therefore, being in Allah's fortress of La ilaha illallah does not mean that we will not experience hardships. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَمْ حَسِبْتُمْ أَن تَدْخُلُ الْجَنَّةَ وَلَمَّا يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا مِنْكُمْ وَيَعْلَمَ الصَّابِرِينَ. Do you expect or do you reckon that you're going to enter paradise without experiencing, you know, struggle and showing patience? The Sahaba came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they asked him, Ya Rasulallah, ayun nas ashaddu bala'an? This hadith is related by Imam Ahmad and Imam Tirmidhi. O Messenger of God, who has the greatest of tribulations from the people? Who experiences the most severe of tribulations? And the Prophet said, Al-Anbiya, the prophets. He said in a hadith related by Imam Ibn Majah, لَقَدْ أُذِيتُ فِي اللَّهِ وَمَا يُؤْذَ أَحَدٌ. I have been tortured for the sake of Allah as no one else has. وَلَقَدْ أُخِفْتُ فِي اللَّهِ وَلَقَدْ أُخِفْتُ فِي اللَّهِ وَمَا يَخَافُ أَحَدٌ. And I have suffered fear for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as no one has. You have to understand now that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has the Maqam Mahmud, the praiseworthy station. He is the Habib of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is not a form of punishment. Allah is not punishing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Allah is raising his degrees. You see, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the great teacher. إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ مُعَلِّمًا. I was only sent as a teacher. So he's teaching us how to deal with adversity, you see. So the point here is to have hope in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is very, very important. Never lose hope. No matter what happens in the dunya, this is the testing ground. We should never lose hope. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. You have in the Messenger of God a beautiful example. Remember I told you that he teaches us how to deal with adversity. And Allah says in this ayah, you have in the Messenger of God a beautiful, virtuous exemplar. And then he says, لَقَدْ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ. For whoever has raja, hope in Allah, وَيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا, and who has hope in the day of judgment, the final day, and makes frequent remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So raja, you see, is to have hope with action, though. It's not blind hope, right? It's to have hope that's backed by action. Blind hope with no action is called tamanni, right? That's a bad type of hope. That's more of a delusion. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, Al-kayyisu man dana nafsah wa amila lima ba'd al-maut. The intelligent one is the one who subdues his nafs, his lower self, right? That soul, that mortal soul that pulls you down towards the earth, that loves the world, that loves, you know, gluttony and lust and avarice and these types of things. The intelligent one is the one who conquers the nafs, brings it down, and works for that which comes after death. وَالْعَاجِزُ, and the unintelligent one, مَنْ أَتْبَعَ نَفْسَهُ هَوَاهُ وَتَمَنَّ عَلَى اللَّهِ. This hadith is in Tirmidhi. Amazing hadith And the unintelligent one is the one who puts his lower self in the pursuance of its desires, of its hawa, and then has hope in God. I hope this happens. I hope that happens. I hope I go to Jannah, yet his food is haram. His clothing is haram. He looks at the haram. He listens to the haram. Right? فَفْعَلُوا مَا تُؤْمَرُونَ As Musa alayhi salam said to the Bani Israel, do what you've been commanded. Islam works if we do it right. If we do it according to our tradition. If we do it according to the hikmah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Don't forget, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to the Quran, was given al-kitab and the hikmah, right? He's given the Quran and also given the hikmah, the wisdom. The ulama say, this is the sunnah. This is how he lived the Quran, the wisdom of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, ista'inu bis-sabri was-salah. He says that, O you who believe, seek help, seek Allah's help with patience in prayer. Right? This is Al-Baqarah 153. Read those sequence of ayat in Al-Baqarah. It's an amazing sequence. Right there in the middle of Al-Baqarah. Right? Seek Allah's help with patience in prayer. Many of our mufassirin, including Imam al-Razi, Ibn Kathir, Imam al-Tabari, they say there's three kinds of patience. Right? Three kinds of patience, or three aspects to sabr, to patience. Number one, being resolute in avoiding sins. Right? Being resolute in avoiding sins. In other words, having self-discipline. Dr. Leonard Sachs, he said that the greatest indicator of later life success in children is self-control, being able to control yourself. That's an aspect of sabr, being resolute in avoiding sins. The second aspect of sabr, constancy in virtuous actions, right? Being devoutly consistent, even if it's small. The Prophet ﷺ said, أَحَبُّ الْأَعْمَالِ إِلَى اللَّهِ أَدْوَمُهَا وَإِنْ قَلْ The most beloved actions to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are those that are consistently done, even if they're small, right? And then the third aspect, contentment in the face of affliction. Contentment in the face of affliction. That you have the spiritual maturity to know that the affair of the believer is always good. The Prophet ﷺ said, indeed, the affair of the believer is khair. It's always good. All of it is good. And that we accept the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is punishing us, then we make tawbah and we rectify our behavior. Right? And we thank Allah that the punishment was in this world. And if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is raising our degrees, alhamdulillah. You see, it's a win-win situation. The affair of the believer is always good. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَقُولُوا لِمَا يُقْتَلُوا فِي سِبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتٍ Don't say about those who are killed in Allah's path that they are dead. بَلْ أَحْيَا They're alive. وَلَكِلَا تَشْعُرُونَ But you don't perceive. وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ And indeed, indeed, we will test you, be shaitan with something. Min al-khawf wal-ju' wal-naqsin min al-amwal wal-anfus wal-thamarat. We will test you with something from fear and hunger and loss of wealth and loss of lives or selves and loss of fruits. Wabashir is-sabirin, but give glad tidings to those who are patient. Ibn Kathir suggests that khawf here, when Allah says khawf, that relates to the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, right? And the ulama, however, they transcend khawf, because there are two ways of saying fear. And of course, fear, khawf, is the beginning of wisdom, as it is said in the biblical tradition, even in our tradition. But khashya is to have fear of Allah with knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Khashya, a fear that is grounded in substantive knowledge, to be in awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But khawf is still there, right? And that's something that the Quran talks about. And then he says that hunger, so we're going to test you, min al-khawfi wal-ju'r, that hunger refers to the fast of Ramadan, right? We fasted 30 days during the month, and it's for some people it's more difficult than others. But that's something, it's only 30 days, right? And it's only from dawn until dusk. So that's something of hunger that we're going to experience. And then loss of wealth, when naqsin min al-amwal, refers, according to Ibn Kathir, to zakat, right? And then loss of selves, anfus, refers to death due to sickness. And loss of fruits, thamarat, refers to the death of children. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he experienced all of these consistently. He experienced all of these consistently, all of these tests, all of these types of adversities. Yet he taught us to say, Alhamdulillah ala kulli hal. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in every state. You see, so know the nature of life in this world. Be patient. Settle yourself firmly in the fortress of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is La ilaha illallah. Then place your hope and trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best of protectors. Okay, now as far as Eid prayers go, I was asked to give a short sort of note on what to do about Eid prayers. According to the dominant opinion of the Hanafi school, the Eid prayer is not performed at home by individuals because it has the same conditions as the Jumu'ah prayer. That's under normal conditions, however. However, it is permissible and recommended to pray two units of supererogatory prayer in lieu of the Eid prayer. So that would be, your intention would be for Salatul Duha. And usually this prayer would not be done in congregation. But there's a difference of opinion. Some of the ulama say that a small household, a small family may perform this prayer in congregation, but they will not add any of the extra takbirat, right? So it's performed like nafila. However, there is a minority opinion in the Hanafi school of scholars who permit the performance of Eid prayer at home with your family, stipulating that there must be a minimum of four people in a congregation. This is not the preferred opinion of the school. However, given our unprecedented situation with COVID-19, the ulama are now encouraging people to actually pray Salat al-Eid at home, whether individually or in congregation. So go ahead and, inshallah ta'ala, pray at home, pray Salat al-Eid with your families and rejoice together with your families. Spend that time with your families. So basically then in the first rak'ah, you'll give three additional takbirs before al-Fatiha and the surah. In the second rak'ah, you'll give the three additional takbirs after reciting al-Fatiha and the surah, although there's different ways of doing it. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all of you and accept all of your prayers and supplication and fasting. رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ وَتُوبَ عَلَيْنَا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى سَيِّدِ مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ بِرَحْمَتِكَ يَا أَرْحَمَ الرَّاحِمِينَ آمين آمين عيدكم مبارك والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.